بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين. Welcome again my dear beloved brothers and sisters to another one of our wonderful programs entitled Ramadan Reminders. And as we begin, I greet you with the Islamic greeting of peace by saying Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the blessings and the mercy of Allah be with each and every one of you. In yesterday's session, we started a very, very important topic, and we were dealing with the rights of the husband over the wife. And on that topic, we mentioned that beautiful statement of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, while he was speaking about the characteristics and the traits of a good wife and a virtuous, righteous wife. And he said that one was وَتُعِينُهُ عَلَى إِمَانِهِ, that she helps him build his iman and Islam. She supports him in acts of goodness. She does not stop him from doing acts of goodness. And she does not support him in acts of wrongdoings, but instead she reminds him and she tries her best to stop him from doing wrong things. So in that way, she can help him to build his Islam and become a better Muslim. And on that topic, I was indicating to the point that this teaching is for everybody, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us as Muslims, as believers, that when it comes to helping and assisting each other as believers and even others, and when it comes to supporting each other, we must know what are we supporting someone in, who are we supporting, what are we helping to build, and the result of that, what will be the result? Will it be good or bad? And if the result will be bad, then are we part of that thing which will bring bad to other people? If the result is good, do we want to be part of doing something that will bring good to people? Yes, obviously. So Allah mentioned to us to help each other and support each other in goodness, in acts of piety, in religious activities, in things that are pleasing to Allah, things that are beloved to Allah, things that bring about goodness and goodness alone, things that brings about help, you know, that you help people who are in need, you know, help each other in this, assist, support each other, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, support each other, give your support for people who are doing good deeds, give your support for people who are propagating Islam, for people who are teaching Islam, for people who are inviting towards Islam, give your support for people who are inviting towards goodness and righteousness, and to those who encourage that which is good and forbid that which is wrong. And this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran again and again about, you know, our support and help. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that same ayah said, who we must never support and who we must never give help and assistance to. He says, وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدُوَانِ, and do not support each other and do not help and assist each other in things that are sinful. Anything that brings about sins, anything that brings about wrongdoings in Islam, whether that person doing it is a scholar or not a scholar, or whether that person is a Muslim or not a Muslim, once that thing that is being done is sinful in Islam, whether it is backbiting, slandering, lying, humiliating other people, degrading other people, making a mockery and fun out of people, or propagating things that are against Islam, things that are haram, propagating music and musical instruments, propagating things that are against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, propagating things that are against the sharia which Allah has given, even though that person might be a Muslim or a non-Muslim, then a Muslim stands on that. It is haram, as Allah has mentioned here, to give our support, give assistance and help to anyone who is doing that, anything that involves sinful activities. Allah says, وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ. Al-ithm means sins, wrongdoings, disobedience to Allah, things that put a person against the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says, do not ever support, because if you support, you will be equal in sin. and you will be punished just as those people will be punished who actually advocates of that action and those sins. So that's the first point. The other point that Allah mentioned here, the other things we must never support each other in, ithmi wal udwan. Udwan means enmity, creating enmity and animosity and building hatred in the minds of people against others, you know, and creating dislike in the hearts of people against other people. So when a person begins to do things, you know, whether it is by speech or whether it's by actions, and that itself brings about, you know, enmity in the hearts of people, it brings about rancor and hatred, and because of that, you have some people, they begin to hate others and they begin to dislike others, and they now begin to condemn others while others might be totally innocent of whatever they are being accused of or what is being said about them. But what is meant there is that, or what is the purpose of such propagation or such activities, is about al-udwan, enmity, hatred in the minds of people, animosity among people, amongst people. Allah says, once a person is doing something, and this is the outcome, and this is what is the underlying objective, even though it may not be said in clear words, you cannot support a person in that. You cannot help a person in that. You cannot give your assistance to a person in that. In whatever way, by even with the tongue, by telling a person, oh, what you are doing is good, carry on, you cannot do that. Or by giving your money towards somebody who is publishing certain things that brings about enmity and animosity, you know, and actually that brings about sinful activities, you cannot do that. We cannot do that at all, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us in the Quran when he says, and do not help each other in sins, sinful actions, and also in those things that brings about enmity and animosity. So as Muslims, we have to be very careful when it comes to giving our monies to propagate certain things, where our monies are going. Because on the Day of Judgment, from among the five questions that every single human being will have to answer before the foot can move an inch on the ground, each foot can move an inch, one question is, where did you get your wealth from and where did you spend your wealth? That's the second question. Two questions will be connected to wealth. Allah will ask a servant, Allah will ask you, Allah will ask me, Allah will ask us, where did you get your wealth from? What was your source of income? And then after that, when we have given an answer, when we will give an answer, Allah will say, how did you spend your wealth? Where did you put your wealth in? How did you use your wealth? So you continue to use your wealth on a daily basis. You are given this one and given that one. But where did you use your wealth? How? And that's a question we have to think about, that we have to give an answer. So that ties in with this teaching of the Quran. Are we using our wealth to give it to other people that will build things that comes about as being things that come about as being sinful, as things that come about as creating enmity, animosity, hatred, you know, detestation and dislike in the hearts of some people against others? What are we propagating with our wealth? If some haram activity is going to take place, and this organization or these people ask you or ask myself as Muslims to donate towards that, and we give the money, and we give money knowing that haram activities are going to come out of this, then we are propagating haram. And we are going to be punished for that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already clearly told us, do not ever support, give your help and assistance to something that is haram. You know, so therefore, sometimes, you know, as business in the business sector, obviously many things occur, many different sorts of, shows and different competitions are held on the outside, you know, but all these shows and competitions, they are totally haram in Islam. They are totally haram. There is no allowance in that. No, so sometimes for the sake of name, for the sake of being a marketing strategy or advertising, that you may give your money towards it. But the thing about it, two things that are important. You know, while you may think that this will bring in you know, more income for you. It doesn't, because whatever your risk is, it will come to you, regardless of what you do, you know, with respect to all these different things that people will do as business people. Whatever your risk is, you can't get more than that, and you can't get less than that. You will get exactly what Allah has decreed for you. And the other thing is that when you give your money, you know, to help towards a first prize or a second prize or a third prize in a certain competition or a certain show or some other activity or some other thing, then you have to ask yourself, you know, am I supporting something that is wrong in Islam? Am I supporting something that is connected to shirk, which is the worst, the most heinous sin on the face of the earth? Am I supporting something that actually the result of it will be a lot of wrongdoings, you know, and indecent actions and immoral actions? What am I really supporting? So we have to ask ourselves that question, because Allah will question us about where we spent our money, on what we spent it, and also that ties in, as I said before, with this injunction which Allah has given in the Quran when he says, do not ever support, you know, whether it is moral support, whether it is financial support, whether it is by doing anything whatsoever that amounts to support, help and assistance to things that are wrong, things that are un-Islamic, things that amounts to sinful actions that are considered to be sinful in Islam. Allah says no for that. You cannot do that as a Muslim. How can you do that and live with yourself as a Muslim when you are propagating against Islam while being a Muslim? On one hand, you are proud to be a Muslim. On one hand, you say, yes, I love to be a Muslim, I love Islam. But at the same time, you are helping things that are against Islam, you are propagating things that are against Islam, you are helping people who want to attack the Sharia of Islam, you are helping people who want to attack the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But at the same time, you're saying, I am proud to be a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But yet you are helping people through moral support or financial support, whatever way it might be, you are helping them against the Sunnah and the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They condemn the Sunnah and you are there to help them and support them. You will be accountable to Allah on the Day of Judgment. You know, there are many things we do on the face of the earth. There are many things we do. And sometimes we justify those actions with our own minds, with our own hearts. But little do we realize that shaitan runs through our bloodstreams. As the blood itself runs, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, shaitan runs through your blood, he reaches to your heart, he reaches to your brain, and he makes you justify your wrong actions. And we don't measure our actions with Islam. We don't measure our actions with the Quran. We do not use the Quran as the yardstick to measure our actions. We are always using our brains and our minds, and we are using our logics and our reasoning, which is misguiding. These things are misguiding, because this is not how Islam is obedience to Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whenever we want to do something, or we want to say whether something is right or wrong, the criterion and the yardstick is there, and that's the Quran and the Sunnah. We always have to get back. So we want to do something, we might be thinking that it seems to be right. Don't take it for granted. Your mind and your heart can deceive you, because shaitan works towards that, and he works in that, as the Quran says, "Alladhi yuwaswisu fi sudurinas." Satan is the one who puts evil promptings into your heart and evil whispers in your heart. So we cannot use our brains, our logics, and our power of reasoning to just justify, you know, everything that we are doing. We have to use that which Allah has given us as the yardstick to measure our actions and our deeds. So we want to do something, look at what the teaching of is in the Quran. You want to do something, look at the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If these sources, which are our primary sources, say no, then no is no, and we can't argue with the book of Allah, and we cannot argue with the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Muslims, we submit. This is why Islam, we are called Muslim, because a Muslim is one who submit. You don't need to make sure that something is acceptable to your reasoning and your logics before accepting it. Submission is submission. We submit to the will of Allah, and it ends right there. So therefore, with respect to this point, it has a general lesson, and that lesson is for all of us. And we needed to be reminded about that, because as Muslims, we find ourselves doing many things people are coming and we are giving them money and we are supporting this and we are supporting that, you know, and so many things, you know, it come about. You know, we have to always ask ourselves the question, what am I supporting? Who am I supporting? The things that are being done, is it halal or is it haram? And if those things are haram, why am I as a Muslim, why should I support that? Why do I find myself supporting something? What account will I give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah has already revealed an open injunction stopping me from supporting such activities? So it comes back to that point again, you know, about the qualities of that wife. وَتُعِينُهُ عَلَىٰ إِيمَانِهِ. The wife helps her husband build his Islam. She supports him in building his Islam. She does not break his Islam. She does not take away his religious actions away from him. That before he became married, you know, he used to be doing a lot of things that a Muslim will normally do. Now after marriage, she is decreasing that and saying, no, you can't do this and you can't do that and you can't do the other thing. No, it must never happen like that. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also mentions that the wife, the duty, the right of the husband over the wife is that she must protect the honor of the husband. And just like it was said that the husband must protect the secrets of the wife, so too the wife must protect the secrets of the husband and must not reveal his secrets, and she must protect his honor. And that's a very, very important thing. And we all understand what honor means, that, you know, what honor means. And when it says that a wife must protect the honor of the husband, she must not do anything, say anything, get involved in anything that will actually bring down his honor. And people will begin to point fingers. Well, if a woman does something wrong, fingers will be pointed towards her. But if she is married, then fingers begin to be pointed towards what? The husband. People begin to point fingers at the husband. So by the wife doing things that are non-Islamic and things that are haram and things that are unlawful, it breaks the honor of the husband. So she must protect the honor of the husband. Very, very important. Protect the respect that he has and live an upright life. Live a life that is filled with honesty. And fulfill her duties as a wife, trying to build a relationship and trying to, there will be knickknacks, but trying to make it work, and also speaking to each other about the things that may happen and how it can be solved. It is not that she takes whatever is in the house and reveals it to outside people, and she begins to all the business of her husband, whatever they may discuss in confidentiality, now she reveals it to her friends or brothers and sisters or parents. She must never do that. She must never take the home business and carry it out once it is understood that this is home business and this remains there. She must never do that. Then what will happen is at times this, when the husband starts to find out or begins to find out that other people know, he will become upset. And when he becomes upset, he will now begin to speak to his wife, probably in a harsh manner. He will retaliate in many different ways, you know, as to why that happened. So therefore, you know, whatever is within the home circle, you know, we discussed this, you know, before when we spoke about the rights of the wife over the husband, but so too is the right of the husband over the wife, that just as he is required to protect her, she is required to protect him also and protect his honor also. And she must not get involved in activities that he does not want her to get involved in. She must not be friends with people that he does not want her to associate with. You know, many a time, you know, we live in this world, this is a real world, and there are many, many cases we deal with on a regular basis, and there are many situations where, you know, the wife has become married, she's married to the husband, and she continues to hang around and be with people that the husband, you know, do not want her to be with, you know, and she spends her time in a way that the husband does not want her to be. This is why marriage is being responsible. Marriage is a responsibility. And when a young girl is about to become married, she must ask herself whether she is ready to assume that responsible role of being a wife. Remember, becoming married means you cannot be the same girl, young girl, you know, moving with friends and family members when they want you to move and when they want you to travel here and there. You cannot be. You have a responsibility and you have a commitment to the husband. Just as I mentioned here, the husband also gets into this marriage and he must know that it can't be the same. You know, yesterday he was with his friends going whenever they wanted to go, hanging out at certain places and for whatever time. But now you are married, you have a responsibility. So to the wife. Must understand that after marriage, she has a commitment to the husband and she must listen to the husband. You are not married to continue to be totally independent, to do what you want to do, be where you want to be, leave when you want, come when you want. Well, then what's the purpose of marriage? If you want to live a life like that, then you want to live a single life. There is no accountability and no commitment to any person. So therefore, when people do not understand how responsible marriage is, then they behave in the same way that they used to behave before, which actually brings about a breakdown in the marriage. Because here is that you commit yourself to each other, but yet want to be the single person that you were yesterday or yesteryear. It cannot happen. So the wife must understand that the husband may tell her, I do not want you to hang out with these friends. You know, I don't want you to go here and there. You know, and it brings us to the other point, that the right of the husband over the wife is that she must not leave his home, the marital home, except with permission. That's a very important point. She must not leave the marital home except with his permission. So it must never happen. These are from our beautiful teachings in Islam and of Islam. It must not happen that the husband leaves to go to work, and without consulting with him and without asking him or without telling him anything, then she leaves the house and she goes about, and then at her own time she comes back and he doesn't know about anything, and she did not get his permission and he did not allow her to do that. That will definitely bring a breakdown in the marriage. So a wife must not. It is totally unlawful. It is haram. It is not permissible for a wife to behave in this manner. If there is a need that the wife has to leave the home on any particular day to fulfill some need, then she consults with the husband. Obviously, you know, husband and wife, they always consult, and the husband himself might say, listen, I want you to go to do this today or do that tomorrow. I need for you to go and pay the bills, or, you know, things like that. So that's a clear understanding. He knows exactly. And by him, you know, allowing her to go means that that's his permission. You know, or, you know, he may tell her, go and drop this, you know, to your parents' place tomorrow, or normal things which we understand. But what I'm speaking about is besides those things that normally will come up, and it is done with the understanding between both spouses that the wife will need to go here, the wife will need to go and drop the kids to school or pick them up from school. That's a normal thing. But besides that, where the husband has absolutely no knowledge and the wife takes up herself and she goes to places, as we say in our Trini language, so to line with friends or to line with family members, and the husband has no knowledge of that. This is totally wrong and it's not permissible in Islam. You know, she cannot just take up herself and go and move as she wants. Not permissible in Islam. So when sometimes, you know, spouses want, they find a lot of problems coming up in the marriage, and they find that they just cannot meet at one common point, and they are always having a knick-knack and quarrel, and that they are thinking about getting out of the marriage and things are not going good as it's supposed to go, or probably as it was in the beginning. It's because of these reasons. If we are doing things that are wrong, if we are doing things, you see, everything that we do, these things bring their own consequences. So everything has a result. If you do something, then whatever is in it, it will come. Every action you have, there are some consequences that will follow. So therefore, it means that if things are being done in the marriage, either by the husband or the wife, then they will definitely bring about problems in the marriage. So therefore, the best way is, as Muslim couples, we have to understand the rights of each other, do exactly that, and always consult with each other. And in these points here, there are many more that we can mention, but these are some, you know, that are very, very important for us to understand. So here, you know, it is expected that a husband understands the rights that the wife has over him, and the wife must understand the rights that the husband has over her. And with this, inshallah, relationship, the marital relationship can go a long way. It will be a comfortable, a joyous, a happy a relationship and a successful one. So we hope and pray that inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless us, you know, and bless our relations in this month, bless the relations between the husband and the wife and the parents and children. And we should try our best to mend the ways and our ways and mend relations rather than breaking it and allowing it to go far apart. Until then, we'll close today and inshallah we'll continue, you know, tomorrow with another one of our beautiful programs. Wal akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.